That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic. Great.
Father, we do praise your name, Lord, in Jerusalem, throughout the world, in Somerville. We praise your name. We offer you the glory and the honor and the praise that is due you, Lord. We give you our hearts. We give you our lives. We pray, Lord, that you would in return give us understanding this morning to be able to be governed by your word, to understand your word, to be able to obey your word, to walk in your statutes, Lord, that we might be that bright light of truth in this lost and dark and dying world. We pray that your Holy Spirit would fall upon us today, God. And again, every word that would be spoken would be not spoken from my lips, but from yours, Lord, unto our ears. Bless our time, Lord. Anoint our time. Bless us with your presence. We love you and we give this time to you. We ask for your blessing upon it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. And let's all turn in our Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 9, as we continue our verse-by-verse study through the Bible. Now, we left off last time at verse 17. But you'll remember how Saul was making his way to Damascus in order to arrest and apprehend Christians. He was going to bring them all back to Jerusalem to stand trial before the Sanhedrin in hopes that, you know, many, if not all of them, would be put to death. That was his desire. But Saul gets just to the outskirts of Damascus, and suddenly a light, we're told, much brighter than even the midday sun, shone in the sky. And then from that light, Saul hears a voice. He hears the voice of Jesus. And Jesus asked him very simply, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul, also known as Paul, he recognizes rightly that whoever this was that was speaking to him, he knew that it was God. And realizing that everything that he thought he knew up until this point about God, he had gotten it all wrong. In fact, he didn't know God at all. And so he asked, who are you, Lord? And God said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. And at that revelation, Saul finally surrendered to what he had been fighting so hard against all along, and that's the fact that Jesus is the Messiah. At that moment, Saul became a believer in and a disciple of Jesus. And he asked a question that every new believer should ask right after being saved, which is, basically, now what? What would you have me do now, Lord, now that I'm saved, now that I belong to you, now that I'm giving you the reins to my heart and life? What does that look like practically? How should a saved person live? And of course, once Jesus saves us, it's his word. It's the Bible that gives us the wisdom and the direction as it pertains to holy living. God's word is what teaches saved and delivered people how to live like saved and delivered people. And Saul is about to become not just a champion and a teacher in that regard, but he's going to go on to author much of the New Testament under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But what made Paul so great, as we talked about last week, was the fact that from the womb, God was molding and fashioning Paul into who God needed him to become. His temperament, his zeal, his brilliant mind, his education, his background, his experience, even his sin and treachery against the church, even that helped fashion Paul into who it was that God wanted him to be, which was, obviously, he was going to become the apostle to the Gentiles. And here are some things that not only gave Paul a unique perspective as it relates to ministry, but also enabled him to do things and go places and witness to people that the other apostles would not have had access to. And whatever it is that God has raised you up to do and to be in this world, you can bet God was training you and fashioning you from your mother's womb since birth. Even the time that you spent separated from God and chasing the world, God even uses that time for His benefit, for His glory, to train us into who it is He desires us to become. Now, some of the things that made Paul unique in that regard is we know Paul was a Jew. He was steeped in the Jewish traditions and culture. He was very, very highly educated, very, very intelligent man, obviously. He was an expert on the law of Moses. He was an expert on the Old Testament. He was trained as a Pharisee, the strictest sect of Judaism. He was trained by the most respected rabbi of his day, which was Rabbi Gamaliel. And once the truth was illuminated in Saul's life, I mean, his knowledge of the Old Testament didn't do him very much good as a Pharisee, but once the truth was illuminated pertaining to how all of the Old Testament and all of the law and the prophets and all of the Psalms, once Saul's eyes were opened to the fact that just the Old Testament from beginning to end testifies of but one man, Jesus Christ, his knowledge of Scripture then became a very helpful tool, obviously, in leading others to Jesus. So he was a Jew through and through. That was a great benefit to him. But Saul was also born and raised in the city of Tarsus, which means that he had been heavily exposed to and was very familiar with the Greek culture as well. Not only that, Tarsus was a free Roman city, which anyone born there in Tarsus would automatically have Roman citizenship, which turned out to be, again, another thing that was very valuable in Paul's ministry because it allowed him to move freely throughout the Roman Empire as he was planting churches all over the world. And, you know, that was something that the other apostles just could not do. It was Paul's Roman citizenship that afforded him the opportunity to even witness to kings, even eventually being able to witness to Caesar himself. And we talked about last week how Paul's persecution of the church prior to coming to Christ is what gave him a unique perspective as it pertains to his own suffering for Christ. So God prepared Paul to be the total package. He was everything that God needed to present, you know, the gospel unto the entire world. And why is it that God would take what was the biggest enemy that the church had ever known, Saul of Tarsus, why would God take the biggest enemy the church has ever known, save him, and then use him in such a way that he then goes and becomes arguably the greatest ambassador of the gospel in church history? And the reason is so that it might communicate to the world that there is no one that God can't save, no matter how vile they might appear to you and I. Now, you'll remember how once Jesus had confronted Saul there on the road to Damascus. He left him blind and helpless, and Saul was led into Damascus by the hand, and he remained there for 3 days in that state. And then God had sent a man named Ananias to go and lay hands on Saul so that he might receive his sight. And then Ananias at first wasn't so sure that was a good idea. And so with Saul being such an enemy to the church, Ananias inquires of God, like, am I hearing you correctly? I mean, I'm thinking maybe we ought to leave this guy blind, you know, and helpless so he can't be a threat to us. But God assured Ananias that everything would be okay. And so we pick up our study in verse 17. Ananias went his way and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And so here is Saul. He's already converted. He's already saved. But he's blind. He's been blind for 3 days. And when Ananias touched him, it says immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he arose and was baptized. So when he had received food, he was strengthened, and then Saul spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. And so Saul begins immediately fellowshipping with the saints. And we see here, thank goodness, you know, he had been very, very zealous for the law. He's no longer zealous for the law. Now he's just as zealous as he was for the law, only now he's zealous for Jesus. He's zealous for the message of the cross. And he doesn't waste any time, championing that message. It says, verse 20, immediately he preached the Christ in the synagogues. And what he preached was that he is the Son of God. Then all who heard were amazed and said, is this not he who destroyed those who called on this name in Jerusalem and has come here for that purpose so that he might bring them bound to the chief priest? And so people couldn't believe it. He's like the worst sinner who ever lived on this planet, the biggest enemy of the church. Everyone had heard of Saul. Everyone knew about him. They knew that he had come to Damascus for the purpose of apprehending Christians. He had done it in Jerusalem, and he had come to carry that same order out in Damascus. And everybody's heard of him, and they're just shocked at this, you know, supernatural conversion. But it says, verse 22, Saul increased all the more in strength and confounded the Jews who dwelt in Damascus, proving that this Jesus is the Christ. And so again, the people are confused. How is it that one who was so adamantly opposed to Jesus is now teaching from the scripture that Jesus is the Messiah? He is who he says he was. What a complete 180. What a turnaround. An enemy of the gospel is now preaching the gospel. And so the people concluded that there's only one way that happens, like a supernatural change, such a supernatural change in a human life. There's only one way that can happen, and it's a work of God. Only God can do that. Only God can come into a human life and drastically, supernaturally change that life. Saving Saul and converting Saul and using Saul ultimately brought glory to God, and it brought credence to the message of the gospel. And it says here something important. It says Saul begins to grow in the Lord. He increases in strength. And the great thing about Saul or Paul is that he never stopped growing throughout his entire life. He says in one of his last epistles, Paul does right before his death. We can fast forward like 30 years or so. But Paul writes to Timothy, and he says in 2 Timothy 4:13, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas when you come. So he's in prison. He's cold. He wanted his coat. And he continues, and bring the books, especially the parchment. So even after 30 years of ministry, the great apostle Paul, like he's wrote half of the New Testament. And now he's at the end of his life. Even he still desired to study and still desired and understood the necessity of continuing to meditate on the Word of God. He never got to a place in his life where he no longer desired to know God even more. He never got to a place where, you know, he didn't desire to be more acquainted with God's word. And that should speak volumes to us this morning. A lot of people have, you know, what we call that, you know, get out of hell free card. I've accepted Jesus into my heart and my life, but then their life, you know, doesn't display anything near of what they profess with their lips. And so I'm okay with having, you know, this little get out of hell free card in my wallet so I can, you know, pull it out whenever I need it. Other than that, I'm going to live my life like God doesn't exist. That wasn't Paul. Paul understood the importance of growing in the Lord and knowing the Lord, growing in greater intimacy with the Lord each and every passing day. If you're not growing in your walk with the Lord, I want you to recognize this morning there's something wrong in your life. We should all continue to grow. If you're a Christian, if you're born again, we should all continue to grow until the day we die. And if you find that you are just kind of stuck, or God forbid, in your mind, you know, you can say with all honesty to your own heart this morning, you can say, I am not as close to the Lord as I once was. If that's you, listen, that is the very definition of backsliding. And if that's you, God doesn't want to condemn you or judge you this morning, but God does want to get your attention. Because after what God has done for each of us on the cross, after demonstrating what great lengths he was willing to go to in order for you and I to have this close, personal, intimate, individual relationship with him, considering all that he did to prove how much he wanted us and he wanted intimacy with us, it is not too much for God to then expect that we would spend the rest of our lives wanting more and more of him. And no matter how well you might know God, if you do not desire to know him even more, there is something amiss in your life. Because the very reason that you are on this planet, the very reason that God created us, was so that each of us would have this close, personal, intimate relationship with him. And God doesn't want that just for himself. I mean, we should all be glad and happy, you know, that God desires to have anything to do with us whatsoever, let alone be, you know, close to us. But God also knows that you and I spending every day pursuing greater intimacy with God, it's what's going to produce and lead to our best and most fulfilling life. Because you'll be doing exactly what you were created to do. And doing anything less than what you were created to do is obviously going to be very unfulfilling eventually. Intimacy with God is what is going to keep your life in perfect harmony. Seeking to have God be your all in all, just letting God be God. On the contrary, if you're not seeking to have God be your all in all, if you're not seeking to be even closer to God with every day that passes, then your life will eventually come crashing down. The Bible says, he who sows to the flesh, you don't reap joy. You sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. You don't reap fulfillment, you reap corruption. And you hear me say often, you know, everybody worships something or someone. Everybody has what they consider to be the master passion in their life. Whatever the master passion is in your life, that's God to you. That's who you worship. Everybody worships something. And if God is the master passion of your life, though certainly there will be periods of tribulation, Jesus promised that. It's not an easy life, being a Christian. But if God is the master passion of your life, there will be periods of tribulation. But understand, you are on the path that ultimately leads to utter joy. If God is anything but the master passion in your life, though there may be seasons of joy, sin is certainly pleasurable for a while, for a season. But if God is anything but the master passion in your life, though there may be seasons of joy, you are on the path that ultimately leads to your destruction. So Saul was the golden boy of Judaism. He was extremely wise. He was highly educated. He was well respected. He was well versed in many cultures. He was feared and honored. There wasn't much that Saul didn't have going for him in this world prior to coming to Jesus. But it all changed. There was that turning point in his life when his perspective, his physical perspective, his emotional perspective, his eternal perspective, everything was turned right side up the day he met Jesus. And up until that point, again, Saul had accomplished a lot in this world. We would look at Saul in our culture and we would call him a VIP. He would be someone, you know, that you'd see on television where people are, you know, they're rolling out the red carpet for. But having met Jesus and having that perspective change as it relates to the world, I want you to listen to what Paul had to say about his prior VIP status or his prior red carpet status. Philippians 3, verses 7 and 8, he says, but what things were gain to me? Everything I gained, everything I earned, everything I became before Christ, he says, these I have counted loss for Christ. Yet indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. Why? That I might gain Christ. He says, everything that I had become, all of my accomplishments, right up until the time that I was stopped in my tracks by Jesus himself, and he's remembering, he's taking us back to that day where he experienced Jesus on the Damascus Road. And he says, all of my accolades before that moment, everything I accomplished in this world before Christ, he says, I count it all as garbage. It's meaningless. It's pointless. Having Jesus, knowing Jesus intimately, is the most precious, most valuable commodity that a human can ever have and know. And now Paul had that. And in comparison, it made everything in this world just seem like trash. Even the best that this world had to offer. His relationship with Jesus changed and put his view of this world in the right eternal perspective. And from the proper, true, eternal perspective, what you are going to realize either today or on Judgment Day, what you're going to realize is that Jesus is and was everything, and this world in all its glory, it's a globe of nothingness. Hopefully everyone in this room has had their own Damascus Road perspective change, where Jesus stopped you in your tracks and revealed to you not only the nothingness that you've been chasing in this world, but also the hope and the fullness of human joy and fulfillment that is only found in a close, intimate, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And then when he revealed that to you, hopefully you surrendered to that, and you surrendered to his lordship of your life. And like Paul, you had your world and your priorities turned right side up. May we all seek to know God. May we all seek to be growing and to become more and more knowledgeable and more intimate with God with every day that passes until he comes for us, which is going to be soon. Verse 23, now after many days were passed, many days meaning 3 years, because Paul explains in Galatians chapter 1 how shortly after his conversion he spent 3 years in the Arabian desert, praying and meditating and, you know, preparing for ministry, studying the word. And many commentaries suggest that Jesus was there with him personally, discipling Paul during those 3 years, just as Jesus had discipled the other 11 apostles for three plus years during his ministry on earth. And then after spending 3 years in the Arabian desert, we know also from Galatians chapter 1 that Saul actually returned to Damascus at that point, and it's during this time, as it says, finishing out verse 23, that the Jews plotted to kill him. So the hunter gets saved, and he becomes the hunted. And what that tells us is, and you might not be too surprised by the fact that, you know, not everyone is just overjoyed when you get saved. When you ask Jesus into your heart, not everybody's going to be happy about that. People are going to ridicule you and make fun of you. In fact, those who stand in opposition to God will often be enraged by someone else's conversion. And Saul, you know, with great fervor and zeal, he had persecuted the church, and now he's about to experience an even greater level of persecution coming back at him because of that, you know, rage against Jesus and the church. The hatred and disdain that the Jewish leaders had toward Jesus and toward the church was bad enough, but now here they are, their star, you know, golden boy, their comrade, has just become a follower of Jesus himself and a teacher of the gospel. And so, you know, their golden boys become a traitor and a turncoat. And so this caused the blood of the religious rulers to boil even more. And now, you know, all they want is for this Saul to be dead. So we got to kill him. It says, but their plot became known to Saul, and they watched the gates day and night to kill him. So the Jewish leaders obviously couldn't kill him out in the open in the middle of the city there in Damascus in front of all the people. And so Damascus was a walled city with gates, and so they watched the gates around the clock, and they figured, you know, he's got to leave sometime, and when he leaves, when he goes outside these walls, then we'll get him. But as we see here, Saul had been tipped off, and you think he'd been part of the religious ruler's plot to kill and to, you know, ambush people in the past, and so he knew the way they thought. He knew he had been part of the enemy, and so he knew the enemy's schemes and tactics, which was another thing that served him well, you know, once he became a follower of Jesus, served his ministry well. In verse 25, the disciples took him by night and let him down through the wall in a large basket. The better translation is they let Saul down over the wall, not through the wall. But as you probably know, it's believed that Saul was a man of small stature. He wasn't a very big guy. And so they were able to tie a rope to, you know, this kind of a wicker basket and then lower him, you know, kind of repel it over the wall and lower him to the ground. And thus, he leaves Damascus in the middle of the night without even being detected. And it's interesting, if it wasn't humiliating enough that Saul came into Damascus, you know, he'd come ripping and snorting. He was going to turn that town upside down, but he ended up getting led into Damascus by the hand because he was blind. And if that wasn't humiliating enough, now he leaves Damascus, you know, a little guy in a basket being repelled over a wall. And just that imagery sort of, I find it comical. But he's not exactly the mighty, fearless Saul anymore, having been humbled by Jesus himself. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, the other 11, Peter and James and John and the others, but they were all afraid of him and did not believe that he was a disciple. Now, again, remember, this has been 3+ years since this, you know, Damascus Road and Saul's conversion and all. And when he finally makes his way to Jerusalem, even after all this time, we see how the other apostles were very reluctant and very unwilling to accept Saul or to believe that his conversion was actually authentic. They thought they were being set up. We let him in, you know, this is all a scheme to arrest us. But Barnabas, we're told, took him and brought him to the apostles, and he declared to them how he had seen the Lord on the road and that he had spoken to him, and how he had preached boldly at Damascus in the name of Jesus. And so Barnabas, everybody recognizes, he's a devout man, loves the Lord. So he comes, he vouches for Saul. He confirms and reiterates to the disciples what had happened to Saul in Damascus. And so the disciples finally received Saul, probably very cautiously at first, but they gave Saul here the benefit of the doubt, which is a good thing to live by as a Christian. Ironically, it was Paul who would later write in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 that love believes all things. What does that mean, that love believes all things? Well, what it means in our vernacular is that love always gives the benefit of the doubt, where you're looking at someone and you're kind of on the fence about who they are and their character and, you know, all this kind of thing. What is your first kind of reaction? Is it to just dismiss this person and say, oh, no, I'm not letting him in. I'm not letting her in. I don't trust, you know, God, my spidey senses are going off or whatever. But what the Word tells us in 1 Corinthians 13 tells us that love believes all things is that love always looks for the good in people first. Now, you might get burned every now and then, but that's okay. God's got your back. But always look for the good in people. Christians always err on the side of grace, right? You agree? So verse 28, so he was with them, Saul, at Jerusalem, coming in and going out, and he spoke boldly in the name of the Lord Jesus and disputed against the Hellenists, the Greeks, and what is about to become a recurring pattern in Saul's life, it says, but they attempted to kill him. And here he is again, first in Damascus, and now in Jerusalem, Saul's first two ministry assignments, people are trying to kill him in both places. And I thought Somerville was a tough assignment. I've got it pretty easy. Nobody's tried to kill me that I know of yet. But something that I find very interesting here is that Saul, immediately after his conversion, I think this is important, because he began immediately preaching the word in Damascus. Then, 3 years later, we find him boldly preaching the word in Jerusalem. And what's interesting is that any time thus far in the book of Acts where we've seen the word of God being preached boldly, we've seen the word of God going forth, whether it was from Peter or Stephen or Philip, any time thus far where someone has been boldly sharing the word, it has always resulted in many people getting saved, and it's what caused the church to grow exponentially. But whether in Damascus or in Jerusalem, there is no account that Saul's preaching up until this point ever led anyone to Christ. He was speaking boldly, he was sharing the truth, but I get the feeling that he was still using the same zealous preaching tactics that he had used as a religious Pharisee. You know, just getting in front of people and all of a sudden he's ripping and snorting, you know, the fire and brimstone and, you know, turn or burn kind of stuff. And he's trying to cram the grace of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ down people's throats. And we see it in pulpits today, you know, people just, it's just fire and brimstone. And the point here that I'm making here is that even after spending 3 years with Jesus, Saul has still not mastered grace, nor had he learned how to share the truth in love. Now, I grew up in and out of all kinds of denominations of churches, but mostly, you know, it was very legalistic ideology that had been implanted in my mind, especially, you know, from the time I was like maybe 19 years old until, you know, my late 20s, where I actually rebelled and backslid and went off into the world for a while. But up until that point, I had this very legalistic approach to God, where I thought, and I had been taught, that God is just this angry God who just sits up in heaven waiting for you to mess up so he can whack you over the head with a ruler or something, or strike you with lightning. And so there was always this, you know, this great fear of God, and thinking that I had to live a certain way, and if I didn't, God's not going to love me anymore. He's not going to let me into heaven. He's not going to, you know, have a close personal relationship with me. And it wasn't until, again, when I found Calvary Chapel and Pastor Chuck, and just the way that he was able to explain grace and how grace actually works in a human life and what God designed grace to do. Because before, I'd go to church and the pastor would give, you know, some kind of altar call, and everybody in the church would go up and get saved every Sunday. And then the next Sunday rolls around, everybody, same people's going up and getting saved again because you messed up the week before. So you go up and get saved on Sunday. Monday rolls around, like it's not even lunchtime. I'm already doomed again, and I'm hoping Jesus doesn't come until the next Sunday when I can actually get back in the pulpit and repent again. And that's how my life was spent in my relationship with God for many, many years, until finally I just gave up and I went off into the world. And then I started to understand and embrace grace. And that's when it changed my life. The fact that I can't make God love me anymore. I can't make God desire to be in a close, intimate relationship with me anymore. I can't earn God's favor anymore, because everything that I am in God and all of God's love for me has already been proven and taken care of on the cross. And so it's not about what I can do in order to earn favor with him. He's already done it all. And when I just rest in that, and I just now live my life in response to his goodness and in response to his grace, I promise you, I'm a living and breathing example that led to a whole lot more holy and righteous life than legalism. Just loving God and responding to his goodness and his grace. And that's why, as zealous as Saul was for Jesus, his ministry was not yet an effective ministry, because, again, he was speaking truth, but he wasn't teaching or leading anyone to Christ, because he wasn't immersing truth in love. When teaching the Word of God, when preaching the gospel, truth and love are the two vital elements, and they are inseparable. One will not be effective without the other. Leaving the truth out for the sake of love, and we see a lot of that going on in churches today, you know, we can't tell the whole truth because it's offensive, you know, it might hurt some people's feelings or whatever. But leaving the truth out for the sake of love is about the most unloving thing you can do to another human being, because love is not love without truth. It's like having cancer and going to an oncologist and the oncologist saying, well, I'm not going to tell him he has cancer because that's going to upset him, so I'm just going to tell him he's healthy. You know, no, I want to know the truth. I want to know everything. And so love is not love if it doesn't have, you know, truth alongside it. There's nothing loving about teaching a lie in order to appeal to a person's flesh. But then when you teach the truth without the element of love, when the truth comes across as harsh and judgmental, that's not effective either, because it deafens the ears of the listener. And I think that the latter describes Saul in the early years of his ministry. And Saul needed to learn that you get more flies with honey than you do with vinegar. And you think about it, every other religion in the world is about beating people into submission, whether it's just in, you know, with the mind, not necessarily physically. But you take the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses, and you got these young boys with backpacks and ties, and they're forced to go door to door trying to meet their quota and their requirements for salvation. And they have these secret parts of their theology that they're not going to share with you on your front porch, because, you know, you have to be high up in their organization to be even privy to that kind of information. So it's like this secret order. But they're trained to go out and to speak Christianese. They give the appearance of being Christian, while secretly, if you knew the real ideology behind either one of those cults, you'd know that they are devout enemies of the cross. With Islam, it's simple, and we see it all over the world: convert or die. They don't even try to hide. But Christianity stands alone in that it's all about presenting the truth, the whole truth, but in and with love. So the Lord's about to send Saul back to Tarsus, where he's going to spend, you know, 7 more years in obscurity, basically. And God's going to continue to work on Saul's heart in that regard. There was nothing in Saul's Pharisee training that taught him how to share truth with love. In fact, cramming the truth down people's throats by force was pretty much what being a Pharisee was all about. And by the time Jesus came along, cramming a lie down people's throat, deception, hypocrisy was what it was all about. Nothing about love and grace 101, you know, being taught in the school of Gamaliel. And so Saul not only had a lot of stuff to learn, he had a lot of stuff to unlearn. It's like when someone comes to Christ from a, you know, if it is a Mormon background, many of you came to a born-again relationship with Jesus from a Catholic background. And when you do, though, you've got all this stuff to learn now about love and grace, and you got a lot of stuff to learn about the Word, because you're not taught the Word. But then in addition to that, there's all this stuff in your mind that needs to be thrown away as well. You got a whole lot of stuff to unlearn. And as they say, it is really hard to teach old dogs new tricks. And so God spends 3 years and then 7 more years working on Saul's heart. Oh, but once his heart has been changed, once Saul finally understood, and I can equate on a small scale, you know, when grace actually becomes illuminated enough in your life to where you're able to finally walk in it. I want you to look at the beautiful words that Paul wrote to the church in Corinth as it pertains now to the importance of teaching truth, but teaching the truth in love. He said, 1 Corinthians 13, verses 1 through 3, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. You ever had anybody clang a cymbal in your ears, you know? That's what it sounds like. That's what the truth sounds like if it's not clothed in love. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, I mean, I can understand every single word of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation through and through. But he says, if I have all faith so that I could remove mountains but have not love, he says, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned but have not love, it profits me nothing. The heartbeat of the gospel message from Genesis to Revelation is truth immersed in love. The Bible teaches us that love is greater than hope. The love is even greater than faith. So Saul, you know, he's ticked off a lot of people here and has not got a whole lot of fruit to show for his ministry. And so once again, he has to flee in order to save his own life. Verse 30, when the other disciples found out that the Greeks were trying to kill Saul, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him out to Tarsus. Caesarea was a port city. And now watch what happened once the Pharisaical style preacher left town and was out of the picture. Then the church throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace and were edified. And walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied. One man, though his intentions were good, one man with a misdirected zeal, a misguided zeal, can be like a fly in the ointment. And so with Saul back in Tarsus, we're not going to hear from him again until 7 years or so have passed. We'll get back to the ministry of Saul when we get into chapter 11. While the Lord's working on him, meanwhile, Luke brings our attention back to the Apostle Peter. Now, it came to pass as Peter went through all parts of the country that he also came down to the saints who dwelt in Lydda. So Peter has been sort of making the rounds. Remember, the Christians had been centralized there in Jerusalem, but now had been dispersed throughout all other parts of Israel. And so Peter's going from place to place, edifying the saints. He comes to Lydda. If you ever go to Israel, you will fly into the Ben-Gurion Airport, which is on the outskirts of Tel Aviv, and it's about 35 miles from Jerusalem. But that area where the airport is located is this very area we see in the Bible called Lydda. So Peter comes to Lydda. There he found a certain man named Aeneas who had been bedridden 8 years and was paralyzed. Can you imagine being bedridden for 8 years? I can remember when I was young, I thought it would be cool to be in the hospital and, you know, just to lay in a bed and have people just, you know, coming in all hours of the day waiting on you hand and foot. Until one day I ended up in the hospital for 5 days, and on the second day I was ready to be lowered in a basket out the window, you know, and repelled to the ground. But this guy has been paralyzed and bedridden for 8 years. And I'm sure that when you become paralyzed, that, you know, when it first happens, that you still have some hope, you know, that this is not permanent. It's human instinct to cling to hope and to believe that your courage, you know, is going to persevere over, you know, the average person. But then, you know, you're paralyzed and a year goes by, 2 years, 5 years. By 8 years, there is no hope left in you. Zero. But what we're going to see here is there is a power in this world that goes beyond what a human being is able to hope for. There's a power that goes beyond the natural realm, and that's the power of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2:9 says, therefore God also has highly exalted him, Jesus, and given him the name which is above every other name. What does that mean, above every name? Well, I used to think that this verse was talking about the fact that the name of Jesus was above the name of any other man or woman on this planet, it's above the name of Bob or Judy or Bill or George. And certainly it does mean that. But it also means that Jesus, the name of Jesus, is above and more powerful than anything that has a name on this planet, including the name of cancer. Jesus is above the name of dementia. Jesus is above the name of paralysis. And Peter said to him, verse 34, Aeneas, Jesus the Christ heals you. And so Peter didn't do the healing, Jesus did. Peter solely relied on the power of Jesus. And then he echoed the same words as he'd heard Jesus say when Jesus had healed a paralytic man back in Mark chapter 2. He said, arise, Aeneas, and make your bed. And then he arose immediately so that all who dwelt in Lydda and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. And so healing this paralytic man causes the whole community to believe and to turn to the Lord. Of course, presuming that Peter also shared the gospel with them as well. And then they submitted to the lordship of Jesus. That's exactly what it means to turn to the Lord. Turn your life, your heart, the reins of your life over to Jesus. And so the work is done there in Lydda, and Peter's going to move on to the nearby city of Joppa. At Joppa, there was a certain disciple named Tabitha, which is translated Dorcas. This woman was full of good works and charitable deeds, which she did. What if your name was included in Scripture? What would it say? Like, what a great testimony for this woman. She's just a human being, just like the rest of us. But the point is, and what Luke's letting us know is that she didn't just talk the talk, she walked the talk. Her life, the way she lived, exemplified her faith. And of course, you know, how you serve the Lord or how you live doesn't save you. Faith in Jesus is what saves you, not your works. But your works do characterize or give a good snapshot of the condition of your faith. Or lack thereof. Paul said in Philippians 2, verses 12 and 13, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, he says here, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And then he tells us how we do that, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Now, it's important to notice that he didn't say work for your salvation. He said work out your salvation. Let the fact that you are saved be evidenced by the way you live. If Jesus truly resides in your heart, if you're truly saved, what he's saying here is that will be conveyed by the way you're living. It can't not. It's impossible to have an authentic saving faith in Jesus and not have that translate into an obedient to the word lifestyle. That doesn't mean you're perfect, but if somebody were going to characterize the way you live, you walk above reproach. Your lifestyle is governed by the word of God. You're led by the Spirit, not by the things of the flesh and what your flesh desires. And James says in his epistle that if you don't have a heart to serve Jesus and live an obedient to Jesus kind of life, understand that that's not a heart issue, that is a faith issue or lack of faith. He says faith without works is what? Is dead. It's a dead faith. And he goes on to talk about how true faith is always evidenced by good works, evidenced by a life that's being governed by the word of God. So Dorcas or Tabitha was known as a woman whose faith in Jesus was evidenced by the way she was living, full of good works and charitable deeds, but we're told it happened in those days that she became sick and died. When they had washed her, that is, prepared her body for burial, they laid her in an upper room. And since Lydda was near Joppa and the disciples had heard that Peter was there, they sent two men to him, imploring him not to delay in coming to them. Of course, Peter's going to come, and you know the story. He's going to raise this woman from the dead. But the Bethels and the, you know, NAR churches of the world, this apostolic reformation, they call it, these churches have taken these kinds of passages out of Scripture, like this one, and they have formed false doctrines around it. But what I want you to understand here is there is no indication, as they would purport, there is no indication in the book of Acts or anywhere else in Scripture that when a Christian died in the early church, that it was commonly expected that when a Christian died, somebody would come and resuscitate them back to life. Now, we just saw in a couple of chapters ago, Stephen was stoned to death, right? I am not denying, of course, people were raised from the dead in Scriptures, in the book of Acts. But what I want you to recognize is that through a decades-long story from the beginning of Acts to the end, 30, 40 years or even more, raising someone from the dead only happened a few times. It only happened a few select times in Scripture, and when it did, it was unique and it served a very specific purpose. Raising people from the dead was not something that became commonplace in the church, which is what Bill Johnson and Bethel would have you believe. And they'd also have you believe that it's commonplace in the church today, although I don't know any of them that's ever raised anyone from the dead. As far as we know, the people that called for Peter to come, it could have been for the purpose of ministering to all the people who were grieving, which apparently there were a lot of people grieving because the lady was so well loved. And then Peter arose and went with them. When he had come, they brought him to the upper room, and all the widows stood by him, weeping, showing the tunics and garments with Dorcas, which Dorcas had made while she was with them. So Dorcas had done many good things. She had a heart for others. She had a servant's heart. So there was a tremendous grief and mourning among the people because of her death. And again, Peter felt prompted to do something that he had seen Jesus do back in Mark chapter 5, which was to raise someone from the dead. Remember, Jesus raised the ruler of the synagogue, Jairus' daughter, from the dead, and Peter had witnessed that. And so just like Jesus did, Peter comes into this room where this woman, they've laid this woman, they prepared her body for burial. All of these people are there mourning and wailing. And Peter does the same thing that Jesus did. He puts everybody out of the room, and he knelt down and prayed, it says. And he remembered the words of Jesus, I think, which was Talitha kumi. Turning to the body, he said, Peter said, Tabitha kumi, or Tabitha, arise. And we're told she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. And just like Jesus, Peter gave her his hand and lifted her up. And when he had called the saints and widows, he presented her alive. And what was the specific purpose of resuscitating this woman back to life? Don't make the mistake of thinking, by the way, that she was resurrected. She wasn't resurrected. She was going to go, she was going to continue to live. She was resuscitated, and then she's going to die, you know, a physical death again. But she wasn't, it's important to know she wasn't resurrected like Jesus. She was resuscitated back into her sinful, mortal, physical body. Verse 42 tells us the reason that God allowed Peter to raise this woman from the dead, it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed on the Lord. So God knew what it was going to take. He knew that this mighty miracle is what it would take for all of the people in Joppa to believe and to have a real, authentic faith in Jesus. And so for their sakes, God did it. God allows miracles. He performs the supernatural because it proves his existence and it validates his word. And thus it is with you and I. Every person in this world that desires to know the truth, God will meet them right where they are. And God will reveal himself in such a way to them that it becomes then illogical for them not to believe. And you might say, well, why doesn't God just, if he wants everybody to believe, why don't you just go around raising people from the dead all over the place? Well, it doesn't work like that. Because even in the parable of Lazarus and the rich man, you know, Lazarus is like, go back, and he's in hell. And he's like, you know, so go back and tell my brothers how awful this place is. And Jesus said, oh, yeah, even if they went back and returned from the dead, no one would believe them. They didn't believe Jesus resurrected from the dead. And so I think if God knew that that was going to lead to an authentic faith, he would do it. I think he'll meet anybody right where they are and give them exactly what they need to know in order to believe. And I think for that reason that the number one reason in the world as to why people don't believe in Jesus and why people don't give Jesus the reins to their heart and life is not because of a lack of evidence. It's because they are so in love with the things of this world, and especially today in the world we're living in. People are so in love with money, or, you know, might be possessions, or, you know, a career, sex, or alcohol, or you know, drugs, whatever sin, whatever is the, you know, the master passion in your life. People are so in love with anything and everything but God that they can't be bothered. They're so in love with this world, they're like, I don't even want to be bothered with what might happen, you know, when I die, or what might be, you know, happen beyond this world. And it's tragic, because you think about it, the average person will spend months planning a 1 week or 2 week vacation. The average person will spend 40 years in the workplace, you know, planning what usually ends up being anywhere from a 12 to 15 year retirement, which nothing wrong with that, until you consider, though, that most people never give 5 minutes of consideration as to where they will spend eternity. The only thing that really even matters in this world, not your vacation, not your retirement, where are you going to spend eternity? And it's mainly because most people, particularly in America, the devil has managed to sell the lie that pretty much everybody believes that, you know what, it's really not necessary for me to think or even concern myself about what happens in the next life, because pretty much everybody goes to heaven anyway. That's what most people believe, or that, you know, all it takes to get into heaven is that you got to be a good person. Well, on the surface, that is true. But what most people fail to recognize is what the definition of good is. Humans think that good just means being better than average. I just got to be better than most. You know, if I'm better than most, then God's going to accept me. But God defines good, and he defines good as being perfect. He defines good as perfection. Man thinks, as long as I don't sin too much, I'll get into heaven. God says, no, you sin once, you blew it, you're out. That's according to Scripture. One sin separates you from God forever and ever. And so, according to God's definition, which is the only one that matters, by the way, according to the Bible, there are no good people in the world. No one is going to heaven on their own merit. In fact, in the book of Isaiah, it's kind of gross, but when compared to the goodness that God requires for heaven, the best human on their best day, the most righteous person on earth, you and I would look at somebody like Sister Teresa, well, that's a good woman, you know, the best human on the best day of their life, even their righteousness, God compares to dirty, used menstrual rags. Not my words, those are God's words. And so you might say, how can anybody get into heaven? Well, truth is, you can't. Nobody can, not on your own. It's impossible. As Jesus said, we're all lost and on our way to hell, but God. We're all lost on our way to hell without God intervening and then coming and making possible what was otherwise impossible. God came to earth and did for us what we couldn't do, which was live a perfect, sinless life. And not only that, he took that perfect life to the cross, because the price of our sin also had to be paid. So he took that perfect life to the cross in order to suffer the wrath that was meant for us because of our sin. Jesus obtained for us something that we could never earn, which is a right standing with God. That's what righteous means. It means a right standing with God. And he perfectly settled a debt that we had with God that we could never in all of eternity have ever paid or satisfied. Jesus, on the cross, said to every human being who ever lived, he said, I'll make you the deal of a lifetime, and not just a physical lifetime, but eternal lifetime. Jesus said, if you'll just put your faith in me, if you'll make me the Lord of your life, I'll take your sin. I'll take the punishment that was meant for you. I'll take, they plucked out his beard. They spat on him. They blindfolded him and beat him. They nailed him to a cross. All that was meant for you and I. Jesus said, I'll take it. I'll absorb it for you. I'll take your punishment. And what I'll give you in return, here's the deal. What I'll give you in return is what you need to get in heaven, which is my perfect righteousness. Only Jesus had perfect righteousness. He says, I'll give it to you. I'll take your sin. I'll give you my righteousness if you just put your faith in me. That's what God did for us when he sent his son. He made a way for sinners, imperfect, unrighteous, bad people. God made a way for us to become perfect and righteous and holy and fit for heaven. Otherwise, we have no hope. I can't do it myself. It's all him, by him, of him, through him. As far as I'm concerned, you want to talk about miracles and God proving himself? The greatest miracle, the greatest healing that God ever performed on this planet is when he saved a sorry, sinful wretch like me. I spent my whole life basically, my young, adolescent life, I spent chasing the things of this world. And I think God allowed me to do that so that I could stand up here today and authentically say to you with all sincerity what a fool's game that is. It's a fool's game. Because you and I will take out of this world exactly what we brought into it, nothing. But still, most people, again, devote their whole lives trying to obtain things that even if you get it, you can't keep. Never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul full of stuff. And the same is true whether you're Bill Gates or your name is Elon Musk or Oprah. So how foolish it is to chase after things that even if you get it, you can't keep it. All while ignoring and rejecting the wealth that Jesus brings into a human life. And it's wealth that's beyond our wildest imagination. And it's wealth that lasts forever. How foolish it is when Jesus up on that cross is making you the deal of an eternal lifetime. And he's saying to you, I'll take your sin, I'll take your punishment, and I'll give you my righteousness. How many people look right back up at that cross and say, I'm good. No thanks. I love this world too much. Or, you know what? I got my wallet here. You might not have known, Jesus. I've got my get out of hell free card right here. I said the sinner's prayer in VBS when I was 8. Don't be fooled. Don't be fooled. Life is short, Pastor Chuck used to say. Life is short and soon will pass. Only what you do for Jesus will last. It's the only thing that has eternal value. Everything in this world, everything else in this world is garbage in comparison. Finishing out the chapter, so it was that he, Peter, stayed many days in Joppa with Simon, a tanner. Undoubtedly, the miracle of raising Dorcas from the dead had caused great excitement and curiosity. And so Peter uses that as another opportunity to preach many days there in Joppa. And we'll stop right here and pick up our study next week in chapter 10, Acts chapter 10, which, by the way, is one of my favorite chapters in all the Bible. And so I'm looking forward to my study time this week. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for the power of your word. Thank you for that deal that you made for each of us on the cross. I pray that no one would leave here today having not said yes to that deal, trading their sins, trading eternal punishment for eternal glory, trading unrighteousness for righteousness, trading bad for good, trading corrupt for that which is incorruptible. Father, I pray that you would fall upon the hearts of whoever you need to fall on today, and that you would convict, and that you would draw anyone that's not seeking a close, intimate, personal relationship with you into that relationship, Lord, into that beautiful intimacy that you have provided and made available to each of us through the cross. Give us the energy, Lord, to continue to be your light in this dark world and to continue to walk in your truth, Lord, despite the temptations and the lure of the world today. Through your power, through your spirit, Lord, guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have never accepted the Lord, if you need prayer, I'm available to pray with you. If you're new here, I want to remind you we have visitor bags out in the lobby there. That's gift bags that we like to get into your hands. Stick around. We've got coffee and donuts and all. No Ignite Youth going on tonight because of Mother's Day. And hope and pray that all of you have a blessed day, all the moms out there. Most excellent way, our addiction recovery ministry will meet here tomorrow at 7 p.m. as they do every Monday. And then look in your bulletin. Make note, again, I'll remind you, the first Sunday in June, we have our church picnic at Wanamaker Park. And then the next Sunday, we have our beach baptism, which is going to be on Folly Beach. And so make a note of that. If you want to be baptized, if the Lord is moving you to be baptized, we have a sign-up sheet out on the carousel out there. And so get your name on there and get signed up. And we look forward to whatever the Lord's going to do there. Let's all stand. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. God bless you all. Have an awesome week.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Somerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.